time you stayed for Records Recital 2, so I'm going to be quick and hopefully not very entertaining. Okay. Well, welcome everyone. Thank you so much for coming tonight. Before I start, I would like to thank all of you, all my new colleagues, all my friends for making Lincoln so much more colorful than what it actually is. And thanks to my professor, Dr. Bach, for all of his help throughout the document and throughout all these 3 years. Then thanks to the rest of the committee members, Dr. Chang and Dr. Eklund. And without further ado, let's start. So today I will be talking about Vivaldi's L'estro armonico concerto in A minor, that's number 8 in the set. And I'll be talking about the original work itself, and then I'll move into the 3 transcriptions made, one by Johann Sebastian Bach, the second one by August Stradel for piano, and then the third transcription made by Samuil Feinberg again for piano, and that's the one that I will be performing tonight. But before we start with the piece, let me tell you briefly how I got acquainted with transcriptions. And it was back in 2004 when I started my undergraduate education with Professor Lamis Vassilialis at Ionian University. You can see him right there. And back in 2004, Mr. Vassilialis started a big project of performing and recording all Beethoven symphonies transcribed by Franz Liszt, a project that still goes on after 10 years. And in 2008, he also performed this particular transcription by Samuil Feinberg. And that's how we started having discussions about the difficulties and challenges that musicians have to deal with, that pianists have to deal with when dealing with a piece of music that was originally written by another medium, and then we are transferring that to the piano. I also found another connection, more poetic and personal connection to the transcriptions, because Lamis Vassilialis was a student of Viktor Merzanov in Germany, and Viktor Merzanov himself was a student of Samuil Feinberg, the one who wrote today's transcription. Samuil Feinberg himself was a student of Alexander Goldenreiser, which was the head of the Conservatory of Moscow in Russia, which was himself a student of Pavel Bast, and then Pavel Bast was a student of Franz Liszt. Well, all of them, starting from Viktor Merzanov up to Pavel Bast, they were students and then faculty members at the Moscow Conservatory. And then Liszt was the one who introduced to Russians the art of piano transcriptions. So now let's talk a little bit about Vivaldi. Vivaldi had the nickname of the Red Priest, and he was the master of the Concerto Grosso. By Concerto Grosso, we mean a piece of music which is written for two large forces, conversating, having a conversation with each other. And so the Concerto Grosso is made up of two parts. The one would be the concertino, which is the soloist, and that can be synthesized by either harpsichord. If we have a concerto for harpsichord in orchestra, you can have one violin, two violins, trumpets, depending on how many soloists the composer would like to have. And then we have the Concerto Grosso, which is the larger part of the orchestra, which accompanies and comments on the soloistic parts of the concertino. The members of the Concerto Grosso are called ripieni. Now, sometimes you can have one harpsichord accompanying both the concertino and the Concerto Grosso, meaning he would realize the continuo for both parts of the ensemble. Sometimes you can have two in larger pieces. Now, Vivaldi composed 9 collections of Concerti Grossi between 1711 and 1729. Just to give you an example of how much this music is, I just only let you know that only the L'estro armonico, the first set, contains 12 concerti, so we talk about lots of music. Now, L'estro armonico was the first of those sets of Concerti Grossi, composed in 1711. And the style is based on the Roman and Venetian characteristics, and Vivaldi based that piece upon Arcangelo Corelli's Opus 6, and that's another collection of concerti grossi. But the difference with this set is that in Les Romanico we can trace elements of the classical concert structure. That means we can trace an embryonic form of the sonata allegro, and also we have specific key areas that we see in those concerti that we would encounter into classical concerto. Then we have aesthetics of romanticism. By that I mean the element of drama is very the element of drama is very obvious in those concerti, and the unique element is that the concertino, the part of the soloists, start monopolizing the interest. That means the solo parts become more virtuosic, and the players jump in very high register to separate themselves from the accompaniment, and that was something unique for the time. So we have also dramatic changes and sudden changes in texture and volume. And then Marc Peter Lehier is a Vivaldi scholar and shares this thought about the concerto in A minor that we'll be performing in particular. The two violins are treated in a soloistic spirit far removed from that of the concerto grosso. Their virtuosity is more venturesome than that displayed in the concertos for solo violin. They give themselves up to the job of arpeggios and brisures that are just as difficult, and they ascend further into the upper range of the instrument. So we have this monopolizing of soloistic interests. Now, let's talk about the structure and the instrumentation of the piece. It's in three movements. First movement in A minor, allegro. Second movement, Largetto e Spirituoso in D minor, and then the third movement, Allegro again, back to the tonic, in A minor. The instrumentation calls for two obbligato violins, two solo violins, and then for the concerto grosso part, the larger ensemble, we have two parts, violin one, violin two, we have two viola parts, cellos, and we also have the harpsichord realizing the continuum. Now, in some performances that we will have a larger ensemble, we might also find another cello doubling the bass line. The form is a well-known for the Baroque era in ritornello form, in the first and the third movement. By ritornello, we mean we have a refrain appearing every other appearing between solo sections, and that's a specific theme that brings unity throughout the piece. The middle movement is too composed. Now, tracing the classical of the concerto structure, and why do I compare that with the classical concerto? We can have the generic structure. As I analyze the piece, we figure out this generic structure of the first movement being in the sonata allegro form. As I said, a very embryonic and very generic part. Then we have a free form for the second movement, and then we can call the third movement a rondo. Why do I say that? First moment, we have two thematic units. The primary theme appears three times, suggesting three large sections in the movement. Exposition, development, recapitulation. The theme appears first in tonic, then in the development part in D minor, and then back to the tonic. Then, the key areas visited in the first movement is the tonic, the medium, something very common in the minor mode, for the classical concerto, then D minor during the development, and that's also a place where Vivaldi explores different key areas. And then full orchestra goes back to A minor and the theme reappears again. And I have a coda here with a question mark, because right before the last ritornello and solo sections, we have a big outdated, perfect outdated cadence that the piece would have easily ended there. But instead of that, Vivaldi extends the movement and he adds another solo, a small solo section, and then the 2D orchestra comes back and replays again this big emphatic cadence to bring the movement into a closure. With the third movement, things are much easier. And we have a single theme, and that's a descending A minor melodic scale. which always appears in A minor between the solo sections. And that then reminds us more of the rondo element. Now, let me give you some examples of the primary and secondary materials and also the theme in the third movement, how it would sound played by the orchestra. And here you have the primary theme. I didn't put the whole score there because there is no reason for that. We will see the whole thing later when we deal with the scores of piano and organ. Secondary material. It starts on the left side where we have the piano section, and that's a contrasting dynamic. So you will hear the theme, then in the fourth section on the second system, you will hear again the ritornello form, and then the secondary material once again with a relationship of a six between the two violins. Different than nowadays. We would have parallel walls in the Baroque, in those Baroque palaces. The ceiling would be very high, providing rich resonance and large reverb, and also most of the walls would be covered by marble. And that, of course, creates huge resonance, right? Especially when we have a smaller orchestra. And just to give you an example of the Baroque concert hall, here you go. And also you can see some of those, you can see also the shape of the ceiling, right? Okay, next thing, oh, before we move to the next thing, let me also give you another quote by Nicholas Honorcourt, which says, these architectural characteristics led to blending sounds together in much more pronounced way. In such a hall, broken chords in fast notes, as found in almost all arpeggios of the time, sound like dramatically vibrating chords rather than finely chiseled as in modern concert halls. And about this broken chord pattern, we will see many examples of that and how both the three composers, deal with that. So, we have a large reverb, right? That makes us think that we need to play slower, so we will be able to hear what's going on in terms of articulation and listen to all the notes. But we have many sources reporting that during the 18th century, the performances were much faster. And our conception about tempo at that time comes from two different reasons. First of all, our mistrust about the performing skills of the musicians of the era. We also think that sometimes all these concertos would be performed under an entertaining situation and not as academically as they would get performed today. So that means they would play everything faster. Moreover, there is a huge monumentalization of those pieces of the Baroque era, because most of the performance practices back in the Baroque period, they would get transferred from musician to musician by the word of mouth. There was no documentation on how things needed to be executed in annotation was much more, was less detailed than nowadays. So during the classical era, that we have all these scores by Beethoven, Mozart, that the composer is the one who tells you exactly what you do, and everything you need to know about the music, it's on the score. So you just have to follow the score. Of course, you have to know how. But going through this period, and then the Romantic period, that many composers drew they got their materials back from the Baroque era, that and not having the academic reports on how these things need to be executed, monumentalized this idea about tempo and created the idea that we need to follow exactly the score and not trust ourselves. But of course, we were lacking all this performance practice information. Next thing, orchestral sound. During the 19th century, the orchestra went through a dramatic reformation to accommodate the romantic standards and the larger sound. The orchestra started having more members, and we have for the first time the idea of the unification of sound. So for example, we have a large orchestra with 10 violins for the first part, 10 second violins, 10 violas, 7 double basses if we were lucky. And we would like to just hear one instrument out of those, right? We need to hear, we don't need to hear each instrument differently. We need this unification of sound. That wasn't the case in the Baroque era, because we would have less instruments and we would want to hear what was going on, who plays what. The instrument sound was much smaller, much quicker, sharper and more recognizable. The sound also would be more colorful and more aggressive. And an interesting fact that I found also in my research was that even the violins that we call today the Baroque violins, they all got rebuilt around 1800s, again to accommodate the sound of the Romantic orchestra. Dynamics is another thing that we need to consider when we transfer a piece from that period to nowadays. We have the perception of the so-called Taras dynamics in the Baroque era, and that means moving from forte all the way to piano and nothing in between. The Mannheim school in the early and middle 18th century, of course, emphasized this idea of being able to do sudden dynamic changes and move around extreme dynamics. But if we go through Vivaldi's music, we can report all these dynamic markings, moving from pianissimo all the way to fortissimo. And of course, this is not something that supports Taras dynamics, right? Moreover, about dynamics, I have two examples here from two works, the 111 and 344, and that's all Vivaldi's. And as we can see here, we have an indication of forte, then piano, più piano, pianissimo. How do we call that? Diminuendo. And then we go from forte to più forte and then fortissimo, crescendo. So we also have these dynamic differences, but we didn't have the symbols to indicate those back in Baroque era. Moreover, specific chord progressions would imply the performer to do a practice of the crescendo or a diminuendo. For example, the first example with the ascending line, though these two would imply a practice of crescendo. And the bottom ones, they would imply a practice of diminuendo. And in fact, the first example on the left, the lower side, that's how the second movement of this particular concerto begins. And there is no indication of a diminuendo. Now, lastly, let's talk about the continuum line. We have absolutely no indications on how Vivaldi would like the continuum to be realized. But, well, and that's from the concerto 311 for violin and organ. And from the second movement of the concerto, as you can see here, the violin is only accompanied by the organ. And what we see here is that Vivaldi realized the continuum in the same register as where the solo violin plays. That was very unusual for the time, because back then we would like to separate the accompaniment from the solo. But here Vivaldi does exactly the opposite thing. He puts them together. and that creates unusual for the time sound combinations. But also, this example here makes the two transcriptions, the one by Bach and Feinberg, very reliable to the original, because they have both transferred the continuo lines on the right hand, in the same register as the as where the solo plays. Let me give you a sound example of that. And within the time period of 1 year, from 1713 to 1714, he transcribed over 20 concertos. Others were by Vivaldi, others by Benedetto Marcello, others by Telemann. But there were also more practical reasons for those transcriptions. Music would come only in parts. As you might know, we were lacking the profession of a conductor back then. So the publishing company, they would publish those only in parts. So you would get, and actually if you go on ISLB, you will see a huge book of Lesser Armonico, all 12 concerti, just volume one. Another book, volume two, another book, volume three. So there was no, a musician couldn't make, couldn't see what was going on in the concerto in the first glance. So that was a practical reason for transcribing those. Also, the realization of the continuum would be a great pedagogical tool for his songs first and then for students. Moreover, the parts from those concerti, they are getting transferred to the organ idiomatically. That means Bach didn't have to transpose them or change many things. They would fit perfectly for the organ. He didn't have also an access to a professional orchestra. He had access to an amateur orchestra, and it would take very long for them to learn this concerto. So by transcribing for the organ, he would have a first-rate performance under his hands. And let me show you an example of the first page from the concerto, and that's the volume one. And the only thing you get here, varies from literal keyboard reduction, that means you literally transfer the music to the organ, more liberal practices, and those would include embellishment of the melody or adding extra melodies to create counter lines. The basso continuo usually goes to the pedal. Also, it doesn't leave any space for improvisation. Everything is written down. And common practice for this era was the second movement to be the place where we're pretty busy for that time. So, the second movement would be the place where musicians would get the chance to improvise and show in those concerti. But Bach writes everything down and leaves no space for improvisation. Also, he transposes the melodic line sometimes between the violins to create a relationship either of a third or a sixth between them. And that depends on how this fits on the keyboard better. Also, he splits the textures between the hands. And here, for example, we have this broken chord pattern that I was referring to that earlier. And that would sound something like that. So it's a linear. There are two linear lines moving horizontally. But now Bach changes that, and he splits this between two hands and also between two different manuals. And the lower manual would sound softer, and the higher would sound louder. So it's, you don't have now a conversation between two instruments like that, but instead you have a conversation going from here to there, up to there, up to there. So that would sound. So he listens to the melody this way. Again, he splits the melody not only between hands, but also between different manuals. And here we have a chord progression that it's a modulatory passage. And by putting one chord after the other in different manuals, he would create the illusion of one chord resolving to the next. So the first chord, instead of having he would add also extra melodic lines to create counter melodies, and you can see those in the little squares that I have drawn there. Also, he fills out blanks in some spaces. Again, the same spot with the chord progressions that would modulate from one thing to the next. That's the score from the orchestra. But then, as you can see at the end there, instead of just having the chords one to the other, right. Right. So he adds this extra melody over there. We move to some examples very quickly to listen to how it sounds in the orchestra and how it sounds with the organ. I'm not going to give you the beginning again because we already heard that. Let's move immediately to the organ. First movement, and here we have the full orchestra descending down in those color patterns, and that's something later that Feinberg, he will play in my performance, he realizes that all in octaves, and it's a little bit uncomfortable. And let's see how that sounds and how Bach treats that in the organ. First, we hear the orchestra. Once again. again, third movement, we reach our famous cantilena section. The cantilena section is where one of the two violins takes over and he sings this cantabile line while the rest of the orchestra and the other violin accompanies that. And as we see, Bach literally realizes that he transfers the music to the organ, but he puts it on the register which sounds louder. So in this way, we will be able to listen to the accompaniment and the melody, right? So let's hear first the orchestra. Okay, now let's hear the organ. Again, notice that the melody is on the higher register. Later, in the transcription by Feinberg that I will be playing, Feinberg listens to that melody as an alto voice, and puts that on the left hand, played by the thumb, while the complement stays on the higher register and becomes very light. Incorporate breathing and that would impact the musical phrase,
of course.
Two key figures for spreading out the ideas of Liszt was Anton and Nikolai Rubinstein. Anton was the founder of St. Petersburg Conservatory, and Nikolai Rubinstein was the founder of the Moscow Conservatory. When Nikolai decided to open the Moscow Conservatory, he asked Liszt ideas and advice on who he should hire to work there, so they would spread out these new ideas about piano. So that, of course, is a basic first impact about this Liszt new school of music. So the program would last. The program of education would last 9 years, and it would include performance studies, composition, theory, history, arrangement. The students during the ninth year, they would have to study all Liszt transcriptions made on Bach's works and come up with their own. And that's how we know that Feinberg, as a student, went through this process of studying those. Although his transcription came up 7 years after graduating, we know that he was aware of this technique, of those techniques. Shortly about Feinberg, born in Odessa in 1880s, died in Moscow in 1962. He studied with Golden Weiser, which we said before, and from a very early age, he was very interested in piano, and they realized how great player he was, so he entered the conservatory, and he performed the fourth Scriabin sonata for the composer himself, and Scriabin said that was the most convincing performance he had ever heard of this sonata. After graduating in 1911, he started a very successful career as a pianist in Europe. He was a member of the Association of Contemporary Music in Russia, although the members of the association there said and say that Feinberg was the most conservative of all. He was the first Russian to perform all 32 Beethoven sonatas, the first one to record the whole well-tempered clavier cycle, and that's the second internationally after the recording of by Edwin Fischer. He was the one who premiered Prokofiev's Piano Concerto No. 3, and Prokofiev said his taste was a little bit too romantic. He was also the first to perform all Scriabin sonatas, and he would concertize those within 1 week in two concerts. Where am I? Okay, he became a professor to the Conservatory of Moscow in 1922, and some of his students would include Mikhail Sokolov and Viktor Mirzanov. His major pedagogical treatise is Pianism as an Art, which got published in 1962 after his death, and that was part of his last will, and his students published that work. Let's move to the transcription. In general, he stays very, very faithful to the original. Oh, by the way, his primary source for his transcription was the Bach transcription, not the original. So he stays very close to this, to his first source, only in the first movement. From the second movement, he finds his own language and he adds more voices. And then in the third movement, he experiments very much with virtuoso accompanimental patterns. So he adds more things. He stays in. He follows the melody as it is, but then he embeds it very much. General practice: melody goes on the right hand in octaves. Continual line or pedal points go to the left hand again in octaves, and the accompaniment is spread between the hands. Whenever we have pedal points in his transcription, he strikes the chords, as we can see on the top example, and then when the sound fades out, he strikes the chord once again, so we don't lose the harmony. He spreads the melody between different layers. On the second example, you can see a melody. Originally, this melody would be seen by only one violin. Hears that as two characters talking, so he spreads that in different registers. He's aware of the most performance practices of the Baroque era, and one of them, and very important, is that the performers would have to slow down and take small ritenuto in the cadences. So, in his transcriptions, not only he he thickens the texture, so the performer will be required to take that small time there, but he also writes down with energy. And that, of course, follows the tradition of the original. In the next example, we can see the adding of multiple voices, where on the first example by Bach, we see a unison line in the melody, and then right from measure 5, we have the add of two more voices. And he totally adds four voices on the second movement. And then we jump to the third movement, and that's again the theme. And here is how he experiments with the accompanimental pattern, and he writes this crazy thing that it took me a while to learn. So, as you remember, the theme in the original is that. But, as I told you about this high A, he keeps that. But Feinberg is not satisfied with it. So, now he writes that. So, he experiments with these accompanimental patterns in order to bring the concerto in the romantic standards. Now, again about the broken chords, he goes back to the original and he realizes those for one hand only, and the left hand doubles that. The cantilena section, as I told you, you can see that the melody is under the accompaniment and is being played by the thumb for the most part, because the left hand has to play another accompaniment in the lower register as well. The Feinberg approach, in general, is the creation of a completely new piece, adapted to the romantic standards. The piano as a medium utilizes phrasing, dynamic contrast within one layer. We can also have balance between the voices, and the control of different voices is much easier than the organ. And of course, by using the pedal, we can build resonance and sonority. In general, Feinberg creates a new solo concerto adapted to the romantic era. He doesn't just arrange the piece for another medium, but he embeds that so it would mask the meaning of the concerto in the romantic era. Before we close, I'm just going to give you examples on the last transcription. This is the transcription that August Stradel did, and Stradel was a student of Francis. And in my opinion, this is an example, well, you will see it yourselves, it's an example of what we would call over-romanticism. And in my opinion, there was this misunderstanding about Liszt's ideas about virtuosity. Many people thought all these experiments that Liszt did in order to reach the piano to its limits and to be able to make the piano sound as an orchestra. Many people realize that as a goal for creation, superhuman would be able to play all these difficult virtuoso passages with these bombastic chords. But I think, in my opinion, that wasn't the idea behind the virtuoso of Francis. And here we have exactly this meaning of over-romanticism, where Stradel gets the texture and he thickens it up so much that it loses its meaning. And basically, I think this transcription is unplayable. Let's see the beginning. Right from the very opening, you see these huge chords on the left, and then the texture is so much thickened up that he even has to change the tempo marker. From the allegro, we move to the allegro moderato e maestoso. That means heavier, right? And then let's jump to the end of this movement, and look at that. I don't know how is it possible to play all that in tempo, some tempo, I don't know. Then, if we move to the second movement, as you remember, the second movement is spelled out, the melody is spelled out in unison. Here, August Stradel gets every chance to emphasize the harmony on almost on every beat by putting full chords. Then, about the broken chord patterns, he stays more faithful to the Bach. Again, two different registers.
Okay, here I have the example by Bach.
And then, that's the only example I found Strato being faithful to the Bach more than Feinberg. And that's the end, that's the thing from the last moment.
And that's the Bach score, that's Strato's score, which also keeps that high A on the right hand. And then we have Feinberg's score, which experiments with this accompaniment.
You ready? There is a coda to that transcription by
Strato, which is that.
It's one whole page full of chords. So dangerous, right, for a baroque piece.
I didn't even try to play through that. I mean, that's added music.
It's not embedded, it's something new. It's one page of extra music material. So, to conclude everything, I hope I didn't go too far. Okay, to conclude everything, I just want to say that each transcription creates a new piece, and we need to treat that piece according to the instrument that we have in front of us and the reason that this serves. It's impossible to try to recreate the original sounds by the orchestra. It's meaningless, in my opinion, because this instrument is different. It works in a different way. The sonorities are different. And you have to solve technical issues that they are far removed from the orchestral ideas. But of course, some things you can follow, like the cadence, the cadenza, ritenuti, and stuff. Feinberg offers a very cleverly designed transcription which respects the original and transfers most of the performance practices of the period. And just to conclude, I would like to give you a quote by Alfred Brendel, who says that it's impossible to stay close to the original because even every edition of older music was virtually a transcription. Bülow corrected Beethoven. Liszt's second legend of St. Francis was inflated by his disrespectful pupil, Stavenhagen, in such a manner that the original looks, by comparison, like a simplified version for beginners. That's it from me. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoy the performance.